To introduce the new president of Cornell, Elizabeth Garrett. As many of you, though she needs no introduction, since she's just arrived, I should get to introduce her. Then we can all say you need no introduction. But as many of you know, Beth Garrett grew up in Oklahoma. She was trained as a lawyer, a clerk for Justice Thurgood Marshall at the Supreme Court, and was a legal advisor at an international claims tribunal in The Hague, and then legislative director and tax and budget counsel for Senator David Boren. She taught at the University of Chicago Law School before moving to USC, where she was professor of law and of government, specializing in legislative processes, and before becoming provost and senior vice president for academic affairs, where she was instrumental in the transformation of USC from a football school to a center for academic excellence, though it's still pretty good at football, nonetheless. We've been fortunate to attract to Cornell someone with her remarkable accomplishments, and above all, her galvanizing personal presence and vitality. So please welcome President Garrett.
Thank you, Jonathan. Welcome to this celebration of the life of M.H. Abrams, one of the greatest professors in Cornell history, and certainly one of the most beloved. There is no clearer evidence of the place of Mike Abrams in the lives of so many, and in the lives of Ithaca and Cornell, than those who have gathered here today to honor his memory. Family members, faculty, members of the Ithaca community, and representatives from W.W. Norton, who have prepared a special anthology of Mike Abrams' writings as a keepsake of today's memorial. And coinciding with this tribute, the Johnson Museum has staged an exhibit of artworks and literary materials that Mike donated to the museum. Many professors leave profound impressions that last a lifetime. Alumni have often told me as I go around the country that interactions with great teachers and scholars are what they remember most fondly about their years here in Ithaca. Certainly, Mike Abrams was one of those great teachers to generations of Cornellians, but he was infinitely more than that. As the founding editor of the Norton Anthology of English Literature and its general editor for 38 years, he influenced millions of students all over the world. I never had the privilege of meeting Mike in person, unfortunately, but I still remember the Norton Anthology from my days in undergraduate, and I suspect that many of you do as well, no matter where you earned your undergraduate degree around the world. Mike spent his entire career, all 70 years of it, at Cornell, proving by example that the best scholars make the best teachers, and the other way around. All my work came from my teaching and returned to my teaching, Abrams said. It is a reciprocal process. That reciprocal process has produced such notables as Thomas Pynchon and critic Harold Bloom, who were among his first students. It produced works of great scholarship, including Natural Supernaturalism and The Mirror and the Lamp, which the Modern Library includes as number 25 on its list of the 100 most important nonfiction books of the 20th century. Along the way, Mike helped to found the Society for Humanities at Cornell and the National Humanities Center in North Carolina. And of course, and appropriately, in the summer of 2014, his work brought Mike to recognition by President Barack Obama in a White House ceremony at which he received the National Humanities Medal for his contributions to literature. Although Mike officially retired in 1983 and became the chair of 1916 Professor Emeritus, he remained deeply engaged in the life of Cornell, warm and gracious to colleagues, including those who took different approaches to the study of literature. In his final decades, he became interested in the accoutive properties of poetry, as it is read aloud, which led to his final book, The Fourth Dimension of a Poem, a work that has given me and so many others a way to more fully explore and understand poetry. I would very much have liked to have talked to Mike Abrams about literature and the reading of poetry aloud, and what it means to be a humanist in the 21st century. I would so have enjoyed seeing him at a football game, which I'm told he never missed. I would have reveled in his wit, his gentle dignity, his kindness, and his wisdom. But unlike many of you here today, I knew Mike Gray Abrams only through his work, a precious gift that he gave to the world. Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr. once described the most substantial reward of a scholarly life: the secret, isolated joy of a thinker who knows that 100 years after he is dead and forgotten, people who have never heard of him will be moving to the measure of his thought. Although Mike Abrams is gone as a physical presence on this campus, he lives on here and throughout the world in the great body of work he has bequeathed to us, in the students that he taught, the colleagues that he mentored, and in the example he set of an ideal Cornell professor: warm, accessible, erudite, someone for whom teaching and the highest levels of scholarship were productively intertwined. This afternoon, as we celebrate the life and legacy of M.H. Abrams and all that he left to us, let us remember that we too move to the measure of his thought.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. Mike Abrams is a remarkable scholar, teacher, and friend, one of the great intellectual figures of the 20th century, and was, as Elizabeth has said, also an inspiring teacher to many generations of students here and across and throughout the world. And for those who knew him, he was a benign presence, generous to friends and colleagues, and devoted, indeed, perhaps I should say, rabid supporter of Cornell athletics, as optimistic about the prospects of the football team as about Ithaca weather. Now, our program this afternoon includes remarks by several family members and friends and colleagues who knew Mike in various capacities, as well as music that was dear to him and poems of which he was especially fond, read by Cornell poets. Now, since this is Cornell and we are in a lecture hall, there is a handout in the program for you. And I now call upon Jeff Harpham, Mike's collaborator, and after which the program will continue without interventions by me.
Mike Abrams was one of the most distinguished and influential scholars ever produced by the American Academy, and was considered by many, including myself, to be the greatest literary scholar of the 20th century. As countless people have attested, he was one of the most commanding and authoritative intellects that anyone who ever met him ever met. But as one of his admirers put it, he didn't always seem to notice how distinguished he was. What struck one in conversation were qualities of generosity, modesty, dignity, responsiveness, and what I'll call, confident that you will know what I'm talking about, amusability. It took some effort in the aura of his charm to remind yourself of his standing in the world. Because he truly did stand in the world. His head was not in the clouds. He never seemed lost in thought, distracted, or baffled by life's little conundrums. He was worldly through and through. I'd like to give you some sense of this quality by recalling a single day that I spent in his company, one specimen day. This was in 2004. He had asked me to work with him and eventually to take over one of his little projects, which Jonathan has already referred to, a book called A Glossary of Literary Terms that had begun life about a half century before as a small pamphlet stapled in the middle, but had become, by the seventh edition, a 350-page compendium, a standard reference work containing authoritative definitions of over 1,200 terms. Over lunch at the Statler, I asked him how he had done it. Of course, he said, nobody could possibly know everything in that book, but if it didn't know something, all I had to do was walk down the hall and ask somebody. And this led to a series of tales about the Cornell English department of the 1950s and 60s, when Goldwin Smith was the center of a swirl of activity involving Vladimir Nabokov, Robert Martin Adams, Morris Bishop, Max Black, Neil Hertz, Paul DeMann, Archie Ammons, Arthur Meisner, David Deitches. And there I was, Mike said, right in the middle of it. Testimony from many sources suggests that Mike was in the middle of it in the sense of being the center of it, but the way he told it, his presence among these towering figures could only be accounted for by a kind of lucky fluke. Then he took me on a walk around the campus in which he took a very personal interest, giving me the past, present, and desired futures of buildings, plazas, and walkways, as well as a lesson in appreciation of the points and prospects afforded by the various places on campus. We stopped in the Johnson Museum for some more tactfully applied lessons in appreciation, as well as an account of the museum itself and the process of acquisition of many of the works in it. On entering one room, we saw the back of a nude woman relaxing in a chair, a Dwayne Hansen figure of fiberglass and vinyl. And if you know them, these things are remarkably lifelike. And I must have looked a bit startled because Mike touched my arm and said, "Looking just as if she were alive. Do you know where that's from?" And then I had my own lucky fluke when I was able to produce the title of Robert Browning's My Last Duchess. As we left the building, Mike pointed up to the room where the Board of Trustees met, which provoked an amazing and deeply ridiculous story about Stephen Weiss, the great Cornell benefactor and Mike's great friend, who in his bachelor years came to the board meetings with a different young woman each year, asking Mike to show her around campus during the times when the board was meeting. One year, Mike said, he decided he'd play a little joke on Stephen by standing with the woman under that window where they could be seen by members of the board and falling into a passionate embrace. He never said whether Stephen was happened to look out the window at that moment and didn't even seem to care. He wanted to show me the plantation, so off we went, walking all around on the path and off. "You have to walk on the bias to decrease the angle of incline," he told me with characteristic precision. His accounts of plants were as detailed and interesting as those of buildings, plazas, and modern sculpture, and included their names, an appraisal of how they had survived the winter, and what could be hoped for from them in the coming years. He took me back to Kendall for a glass of wine on the patio. He was in a reminiscing mood, so I heard all manner of stories, including one that gave him particular pleasure about a car trip through Europe with his daughters when they were little girls. "This was, of course, many years ago," he said. "I'm 92. Did you know I was that old?" Well, of course I did. I had first read him in 1968 and had regarded him then as a very senior figure. But I hadn't known that, as he then told me, that he could recall hearing Woodrow Wilson speak in favor of the League of Nations. He told me about Ruthie, whom he visited several times a day on a regular schedule. And incidentally, 2 years later, after this date, I invited him to the National Humanities in North Carolina, where he was one of its founders, to give a talk and to celebrate the endowment by, of course, Stephen Weiss of the M.H. Abrams Fellowship at the center. The two of them had flown down in Stephen's plane. Mike gave a brilliant talk on the fourth dimension of a poem, followed by dinner, followed by festivities, and then Stephen flew Mike back to Ithaca, where he did not miss the last scheduled visit of the day. Back to 2004. At dinner that night, he talked about his wartime work in the psychoacoustical lab, and then following the war, how he went to work at Cornell. "When I saw the university in the city," he said, "I knew right away that there was no place else for me." He mentioned a memorial service like this one for the physicist Hans Bethe, at which Hunter Rawlings had remarked, "We are here to celebrate the life of the greatest professor in the history of Cornell." And Mike said, "I immediately thought, yes, of course, he's right." And I immediately thought, well, if that list could be extended to two. He returned to the subject of the glossary. "I think we need to have an entry on rap, don't you?" I hadn't thought that, in fact, and I was aghast when he suggested that, given my extreme youth, I should do that one. I did my best, but in a characteristically positive gesture, Mike insisted on revising my contribution to include an uplifting verse from Queen Latifah that counterbalanced rap's customary violence and misogyny. Where did he come up with that? What's the music scene at Kendall like? And then in the version of this entry that actually appeared in the finished book, he added something else as well, a comparison between the rhythms of rap and those of Old English poetry. also suggested that we should have examples of limericks, but the problem was that many limericks were unsuitable. Like the one he recited while the young woman from Ithaca, who was waiting for our orders, waited, about the young woman from Chichester, whose shape made the saints in their niches stir. Each morning at matins, the sound of her satins made the bishop of Chichester's britches stir. Did you know I was that old? He suggested that I try to find something more congruent in tone with the rest of the book, and was delighted when I came up with one by his friend Morris Bishop. As he drove me back to the Stadler, he commented on the German car that his daughters had urged him to get for its safety features. It was dark, it was late, and the roads, as you know, are neither straight, nor flat, nor wide, nor illuminated. And yet, see how well it takes the turns, even its good speed. And that was our day. I want to say one more thing about Mike's worldliness. As you know, he published a book in 2012 on his 100th birthday. The book contained the essay I referred to earlier, The Fourth Dimension of a Poem, which many of you have heard Mike read some more than once. That essay concerned the effect created by the sounds of the words in a poem, and even by the activity of vocalizing those sounds. Many people of a great age, or even of a less great age, become fond of generalizations, vague sentiments, reliable formulae that without much work appear to reflect immense and timeless wisdom. In his 10th decade, Mike challenged himself with a highly demanding microanalysis of the interplay of sound and meaning, the psychoacoustics of poetry, as the lips and tongue and palate worked in concert with each other and with the mind and the soul to produce beauty and illumination. His final scholarly work was devoted to liberating great poetry, including a poem by Archie Ammons that we'll hear very shortly, from the prison of print and restoring it to the life of the body and the world, the only life, I think, that Mike, for all his scholarly gifts, was interested in.
I'm Robert Morgan, and I'll read the poem, The Solitary Reaper. Just think of the highlands of Scotland. We're having sort of Scottish weather today, so this may be appropriate. Behold her, single in the field, yon solitary Highland lass, reaping and singing by herself. Stop here, or gently pass. Alone she cuts and binds the grain, and sings a melancholy strain. Oh, listen, for the vale profound is overflowing with the sound. No nightingale did ever chaunt more welcome notes to weary bands of travelers in some shady haunt among Arabian sands. A voice so thrilling ne'er was heard in springtime from the cuckoo bird, breaking the silence of the seas beyond the stormy Hebrides. Will no one tell me what she sings? Perhaps the plaintive numbers flow for old, unhappy, far-off things and battles long ago. Or is it some more humble lay, familiar matter of today, some natural sorrow, loss, or pain that has been and may be again? Whate'er the theme, the maiden sang, as if her song could have no ending. I saw her singing at her work and o'er the sickle bending. I listened motionless and still. And as I mounted up the hill, the music in my heart I bore. Long after, it was heard no more.
I'm Julia Reidhead. I'm honored to join the Abrams family and friends and Cornell community today to speak about Mike's almost 60-year relationship with W.W. Norton and Company. When Mike died, Drake McFeely, Norton's president, sent a message to the firm that, quote, Norton has lost one of its greatest friends and the most important author on our list. The landmark Norton Anthology of English Literature, of which Mike was the founding general editor, transformed the teaching of the survey course and became the way that many millions of students worldwide have been introduced to the breadth of literature in English. It was also the model for all other Norton anthologies, many of which Mike had a direct hand in. So Mike's work has also touched the lives of students in world, American, African American, and women's literature courses, among others. At the same time, Mike served as advisory editor for the Norton Critical Editions, now 247 in number. In a message to Norton employees about Mike's 100th birthday celebration, Drake described our publishing company as the house that Mike built. This is a creation myth that happens to be true. I was not present at the creation. When the Norton Anthology of English Literature was published in 1962, I had just celebrated my first birthday. My relationship with Mike began in earnest 30 years later when my Norton Anthology mentor, Mike's longtime friend and editor, John Benedict, died far too young. I was suddenly Mike's new editor. It was a May-December match, and I was December. I was a Yale comparative lit major and a cannon-blasting feminist. I was a hard-charging college saleswoman turned street-smart New Yorker. I meant business. With cordial, if reserved, professionalism, I communicated with Mike by email for some time. I think he dictated his email to the invaluable Diane Ferris, until matters called for a phone conversation. Hello, Mike. This is Julia Reidhead from Norton. Well, hello, kitten. I'd been disarmed. I doubt Mike gave it a second thought, but in a word, he banished self-seriousness from our relationship. And for the next 25 years, Mike guided me as I worked as an in-house editor with the great scholars and critics and teachers whose editorial work sets the standards for which the Nortons are known. I owe Mike deep thanks for inventing, with Norton's then president, George Brockway, the Norton anthologies in the late 1950s, and 35 years later for teaching me, by his example, the editor's art, when to push, when to pull, how to gently prevail. You see, Mike thought like a publisher. So it was no surprise to learn a few years ago that Mike's first business card, printed when around 1940, read, M.H. Abrams, tutor in all subjects. I wasn't his only tutee, as this mini anthology of fond remembrances attests. Stephen Greenblatt, Kogan University professor at Harvard, shared this, quote, I had the great good fortune to disagree in public years ago with Mike Abrams the first time we met. I cannot recall the exact occasion, though our disagreement had to do with the relationship between literature and history. I am quite confident that in his cheerful, friendly, yet quite tenacious way, Mike got the better of me. Why then was it my good fortune? Because it turned out that unlike so many grand figures in our profession and others, M.H. Abrams actually enjoyed being challenged. He had, it seemed to me, a serene sense of his own intelligence, a clear-eyed grasp of his guiding principles, and a pleasant self-assurance that came from having written books that had changed the shape not only of his particular field, but also of the entire enterprise of literary study. But for all that, he had not a trace of arrogance or pomposity. He never thought that the world began and ended with his particular viewpoint upon it. And he was interested in what others had to say, even if they did not agree with him or he with them. That's how our friendship began, and over the years it flourished. And at a certain point, to my astonishment and my deep gratification, Mike asked me if I would be interested in being his successor as general editor of the Norton Anthology of English Literature. I knew how much the anthology meant to him personally, as well as to the profession. And hence I understood the trust he was confiding in me. I accepted the offer because I knew that his gracious sensibility accepted the possibility and indeed the inevitability of change. That acceptance was built into the anthology as he had shaped it from the beginning, and it was built into his whole personality. I learned from him, not as a lesson I could ever master, but as a model to which I could aspire, what it meant to be a wise editor, a generous mentor, and a large-spirited human being, end quote. Sandra Gilbert, distinguished professor emerita at the University of California, Davis, and Cornell's first M.H. Abrams distinguished visiting professor, writes, "Mike Abrams was without question the best teacher I had in my undergraduate and graduate career, the most learned, the most nuanced, the most incisive. In my 4 years at Cornell, I took 4 memorable classes with him. All were compelling, and one, a seminar in critical theory focused on a deep analysis of Lycidas, was transformative. Uncle Mike, as I came to call him over the years, not just out of affection, but also out of a yearning to really be one of his descendants, guided Susan Gubar and me as we drafted introductions and headnotes for the first edition of the Norton Anthology of Literature by Women. At one point, we came to the vexed position of early modern women writers, and reflecting a view current among some feminist historians, questioned whether women ever indeed had a renaissance, given the absence of female Shakespeare's, Spencer's, Johnson's. Uncle Mike scribbled in the margins, mentioned women worthies, probed and protested. He wanted, as he always did, in and out of the classroom, more nuance. And he helped us to ask a new question. How did women have a renaissance? Decades after I graduated, he was still teaching me to think. And the great publisher and Norton's longtime CEO and president, Donald S. Lamb, shared a portrait of Mike Abrams as a young man. When Mike's name came up for an honorary degree at Yale, his nomination was put on the fastest possible track for fear that he might not survive long enough to appear at commencement that year. And then a few days before the ceremony, the university's secretary got in touch with me, expressing concern whether Professor Abrams would be able to climb the flight of stairs leading to the corporation's boardroom where tradition called for the robing ceremony. Her concern was needless. Mike mounted those stairs so quickly that I had trouble keeping up with him. He was, of course, a mere youngster of 95 at the time. Mens sana in corpore sano. How many nonagenarians, let alone centenarians, could match that ideal? Those of us who knew Mike over nearly 6 decades would never have doubted it. End quote. Stephen, Sandra, Don, Drake, and I are all fortunate residents of the house that Mike built. One trait we will always share with Mike is a deep love of its building materials. Literature is its bricks and beams. When in 2012 the New York Times Book Review ran a back page feature about the 50th anniversary of the Norton anthologies, Mike, combining cheer and utter seriousness, made clear why the study of literature matters. New York Times. For a prospective undergraduate reading this Q&A, how would you answer the question, why study literature? Abrams. Ha! Why live? Life without literature is a life reduced to penury. It expands you in every way. It illuminates what you're doing. It shows you possibilities you haven't thought of. It enables you to live the lives of other people than yourself. It broadens you. It makes you more human. It makes life more enjoyable. There's no end to the response you can make to that question. It enables you to live the lives of other people than yourself. Rereading those words, I remember a visit Mike and I made to the underground vault of the Folger Shakespeare Library. We donned white cotton gloves while our host retrieved four or five of their many first folios of Shakespeare. Mike's delight may have been in seeing familiar friends. Ah, Compositor B, where was his head? Such carelessness. Or in seeing me breathlessly put a gloved finger on the page, alive to the wonder that another reader had touched it in 1623. Surely it was the combination, connecting the student to the great work, that delighted Mike over a lifetime of teaching. It expands you in every way. It illuminates what you're doing. It shows you possibilities you haven't thought of. In December 2011, I spent an afternoon in Mike's living room at Kendall while he recorded poems to accompany his new book, The Fourth Dimension of a Poem. He'd chosen a dozen and read each in his distinctive, lustrous voice. Between takes, Mike would fondly comment on each poem. Ah, here's Tennyson, so good, yet so underrated. I felt I was part of the ultimate insider's poetry seminar. Mike had saved Wordsworth's Tintern Abbey for last, commenting that he might not have the stamina for all 159 lines. But when he began to read, his energy intensified, and as he spoke the lines, they became unforgettably alive. For those few minutes, I had a window into two pasts, the great poets and the great teachers, linked by language, imagination, and deep love. Here, I marveled, was my experience of the mirror and the lamp. And as if the decades working together on Norton anthologies weren't lesson enough in language and love. Some years ago, when I was in intensive care after a serious accident, Mike sent this note, 31 July 2008. Very dear Julia, I was just now shocked to learn by forwarded email of your accident in the surf. I've also heard that the auspices are very encouraging, so hurry up and get well, because you are indispensable, not only for your matchless talents and skills, but for what you are. With my love, Mike Abrams. So I will finish then by sending these words heavenward. Very dear Mike, I hope you are comfortably reading under a tree. I draw on your wisdom daily because you are indispensable, not only for your matchless talents and skills, but for what you are. With my love, Kitten. Thank you.
I am Ken McClane. From Ode to the West Wind. Make me thy lyre even as the forest is. What if my leaves are falling like its own? The tumult of thy mighty harmonies will take from both a deep autumnal tone, sweet though in sadness. Be thou spirit fierce, my spirit. be thou me, impetuous one. Drive my dead thoughts over the universe like withered leaves to quicken a new birth. And by the incantation of this verse, scatter as from unextinguished hearth, ashes and sparks, my words among mankind. Be through my lips to awakened earth the trumpet of a prophecy. O wind, if winter comes, can spring be far behind?
I'm Judy Abrams, the second daughter. In 2007, when Dad was a mere 94 years old, he gave a talk at Wells College. The next day, he reported with some amusement that at the end of the lecture, one of the students asked, "How did you get to be so old?" I wish I could remember his answer. He said something like, "One day at a time," or "I didn't really plan on it." Whatever he said, I think I know the reason. The answer: there are two main reasons. The obvious reason is genetics. A few years ago, I sent Dad's DNA off to be analyzed. I was trying to find any long-lost relatives, but what I did find was that Dad had twice as much Neanderthal DNA as the rest of us. I don't know if the Neanderthal strain explains his choice of careers, but I do hold it accountable for the following story. As most of you know, Mom had Alzheimer's disease for many years. When her condition deteriorated to the point that she couldn't go out anymore, Dad opted to stay home with her for more than 4 years. He stopped going to his office and he gave up most of his other activities. As Mom got worse, she stopped demanding the constant presence of family members and accepted help from caretakers. So at the age of 90, Dad resumed his activities. He started working out at the Kendall gym to get back in shape. After about a month, he told me that his shirts were getting too tight. "I think I'm bulking up," he announced. Perhaps the more important reason that Dad got to be so old was his attitude. Dad was always the ultimate optimist. Our family went to one of the local parks almost every day during the summer. It was Ithaca, so of course the weather was changeable. I can't begin to count the number of times that Mom, Jane, and I sat imprisoned in the car while it rained, poured, or occasionally hailed. "It's just a shower. It will clear up any minute," Dad would announce brightly. Sometimes he was right. It seemed that Dad lived a charmed life, but of course he lived through all the catastrophic events that every centenarian has endured. He just chose to focus on life's sunnier moments. For instance, Dad described his personal experience of the Great Depression as follows. "It was so much fun. Ruthie and I would sit on the curb outside the music clubs and listen to great jazz for free while we shared an ice cream cone." I don't remember Dad talking about his career when I was growing up. He was such an enthusiast about nature, sports, music, and friends that no one topic stood out. I do remember noticing when I was very young that Dad loved language in a visceral way. I could see that he would pause for an instant to search for the perfect word and then delight in pronouncing that word as though he was tasting it. I didn't realize that Dad was becoming famous. It wasn't until I was in college that I became aware of his fame, at least his fame in certain circles. It must have been about 1969, and I was visiting Jane and her husband in New York City. The two of them decided to impress Dad by inviting him to Max's Kansas City. I don't know if all of you remember Max's Kansas City, but it was the hottest place in New York. The cream of the counterculture hung out there, including Andy Warhol's gang, rock musicians, artists, poets, sculptors, and writers. I couldn't wait. I put on my best miniskirt. When we got to Max's, I was the first one to approach the bouncer. He scowled at me disapprovingly, glared back and forth from me to my ID several times, and then grudgingly let me in. He gave Jane and her husband the same treatment. Dad was next in line. The bouncer looked up. He flashed a huge smile. "Professor Abrams, come right in." We were ushered to a central table. It didn't end there. Everyone in the place came to our table to talk to Dad. It was utterly humiliating. I know that Dad's many accomplishments are being cited this afternoon, but in addition to the accolades Dad got from his students, colleagues, and publishers, he received fan letters every month or so from Australia, India, Japan, Iran, Afghanistan. The authors all wanted to let Dad know that reading his works had changed their lives. He had opened their minds, gotten them through difficult periods, or led them to change their careers. I've always been amazed how many people have told me that they keep a copy of the Norton Anthology on their bedside table for nightly readings. We miss Dad's enthusiasm, his smile, his good humor, his amazing storytelling ability, and his lovely disposition. One of Dad's greatest passions was music. When he came to Cornell, he started playing recorder music with a group that met once a month for decades. I can remember the lovely sound of Elizabethan music floating up from the living room, lulling me to sleep when I was young.
Thank you. My name is Sarah Brennan, and I'm Mike Abrams' granddaughter, and it's really a pleasure to be here with you today. So far, he's come back to life through all the remarks that you've made. It's been making me cry. Like what his colleagues have said, his editor has said, he really was that gentle, caring, warm person in addition to his intellect and his professional accomplishments. And I just wanted to share with you briefly a little bit about what I experienced of Mike, or Papa as I called him, as his granddaughter. My biggest memory of Papa is that whenever we came up to Ithaca, which we did about five times a year when I was growing up, is we had a little ritual, Papa and I. Once the car was unloaded, he would take my hand and he would take me on a walk around the highland, around the block, which was a pretty long walk when you had little legs growing up, and he was extremely patient. He would just take that time and listen. He really did not talk during those walks. He wanted to know about what was going on in my life, and he was just very humble. That's what I remember. It wasn't as though, you know, as his granddaughter, I was in awe of him. He was very concerned with connecting to me and learning about my life and really sharing love with me and making me feel appreciated. I found a picture recently of us when I was still really little. I was about 4 or 5 in this photo, and Papa was in his early 70s. And in the photo, he was looking very, you know, dapper as he did, and very svelte and kind of poised. And he had his hand on one hip, and he had his other hand on his pipe, which he didn't give up until I think probably his 80s. So he was still smoking his tobacco pipe, and he kind of had this slightly inscrutable but amused look on his face, kind of looking into the distance. And then there I am as a little 5-year-old, and I'm trying to imitate his motions and also trying to have an inscrutable look on my face, which is, of course, impossible for a 5-year-old to do. So when I saw that photo, I was reminded of how much I have looked up to him my whole life, but it really has come from a place of love and affection. And just one more reflection that I wanted to share with you, and it actually relates to a quote that has already been shared that's on the back of the program. But one thing that I hadn't really reconciled until actually after his passing and after being able to read reflections about him and read some more of his work and interviews that had been, you know, recirculated. And that is that since I looked up to him so much as a little girl, I wanted to be an English professor. So for many years in my mind, that's what I was going to do with my life. And then I got to college, and it turns out I actually fell in love with something else, which is the social sciences, and I have a real passion for social justice and public policy and how those two intersect. And so that is where my professional career has led me to. And for a long time until this year, I'd always thought, my path really diverged from that example that I looked up to so much growing up. But reading on his works and really understanding that he was coming to the place of language from such a deep love and appreciation for what it means to be human and how literature reflects us to ourselves, I've just been so grateful that this has made me realize that my path actually is still following his, and I'm still following in his footsteps. And so I just wanted to read the quote that actually not only his editor, his kitten, shared, but I won't reread it, but it is on the back of the program. And the line that really stands out to me is that it broadens you, it makes you more human. And to me, I just really thank Papa for showing me and many others what it means to be more human. Thank you.
Growing up, I wasn't aware that my father was a colossus in the world of literary studies and scholarship. Among my first memories, when I was 4, was answering the phone one evening after dinner in the house on State Street in Ferris Place, where we lived then. And after listening carefully, I said, "No, he's not here," and hung up. My father asked gravely who the call had been for. "For Dr. Abrams," I said. Learning that he could indeed be addressed as Dr. Abrams was the first of many lessons on his standing in the world. At about 21, I discovered to my chagrin I could hardly take him anywhere without his attracting attention, generally from former students. And Judy spoke about one of those notable occasions. Before then, he was at times merely embarrassing. The photo on the bookmark reminds me of the time I was 13, returning from several days of canoeing with the Girl Scouts in the Adirondacks. As we made a final turn in our little group of canoes toward home base on the solitude of Saranac Lake, a canoe appeared heading toward us in the distance, paddled to my horror by my mother and father, who were mystified that I was far from pleased. Dad was passionate about many things, starting perhaps with Cornell, talking about the new tech campus to be built on Roosevelt Island. He told us he thought that with its completion, Cornell would be recognized as truly the finest American university. Dad prized intelligence. When we first brought Sarah, then 10 weeks old, to Ithaca to meet her grandparents, Dad got down on his knees to lean over her. "Look at her," he said. "She radiates intelligence." To which I have to add, Sarah and I, talking last night, my son Ben reminded us that he is the only other person in the family to have graduated Phi Beta Kappa. Dad had an extraordinary memory. Until just a few years ago, we consulted him on things we'd forgotten, but that he remembered, along with seemingly everything he had ever read and thought about. As he was wheeled out of the recovery room following surgery for a broken hip some years ago, Judy asked if he was somewhat confused, as we'd been warned to expect. He replied emphatically, "I'm sharp as a tack." And so he remained until after his 100th birthday. High up on his list of passionate lifelong interests was music. He served for years on the committee hosting leading musicians at Cornell, delighted in the Elizabethan music the recorder group played and the Mozart and Schubert compositions for four hands that Judy and I used to play. Romantic music figured prominently among his favorite works. About 10 years ago, he informed us that he decided Schubert was his favorite composer. He instructed my husband, Ed, that he wanted the Schubert String Quintet in C, the cello quintet, to be played at his memorial service. Beginning to worry that Dad might outlive him, Ed arranged to have a group perform the quintet for his 99th birthday at Kendall Retirement Home. It was the talk of the place for weeks afterward, Dad told us happily. Today, to honor Dad's wish, we'll hear the haunting music of the quintet's second movement, composed in September 1828, during the final weeks of Schubert's life.
Thank you. I'm Alice Fulton, and I'm reading a poem by Keats. To Autumn. Season of mists and mellow fruitfulness, close bosom friend of the maturing sun, conspiring with him how to load and bless with fruit the vines that round the thatch eaves run, to bend with apples the mossed cottage trees and fill all fruit with ripeness to the core, to swell the gourd and plump the hazel shells with a sweet kernel, to set budding more and still more later flowers for the bees until they think warm days will never cease. For summer has o'erbrimmed their clammy cells. Who hath not seen thee oft amid thy store? Sometimes whoever seeks abroad may find thee sitting careless on a granary floor, thy soft hair lifted by the winnowing wind, or on a half-reaped furrow sound asleep, drowsed with the fume of poppies, while thy hook spares the next swath and all its twined flowers. And sometimes, like a gleaner, thou dost keep steady thy laden head across a brook, or by a cider press, with patient look, thou watchest the last oozings, hours by hours. Where are the songs of spring? Aye, where are they? Think not of them. Thou hast thy music too. While barred clouds bloom the soft dying day and touch the stubble plains with rosy hue, then in a wailful choir the soft gnats mourn among the river sallows, borne aloft or sinking as the light wind lives or dies. And full-grown lambs loud bleat from hilly bourn. Hedge crickets sing, and now, with treble soft, the redbreast whistles from a garden croft, and gathering swallows twitter in the skies.
Hello, I'm Paul Sawyer, and I'm going to repeat the number of the themes that came up this afternoon, but from the point of view of somebody who taught with Mike, I was his colleague for 40 years, and I taught with him during the years that he donated his teaching of the English literary tradition free to Cornell University after his retirement in 1982. He was a wonderful teacher, as I'm sure everyone in this room knows, partly because his understanding of literature was bound up with teaching in a very profound way. Surely nobody has brought more human beings together with more texts than Mike did in the Norton anthologies. But also, his view of literature was that it was fundamentally a process of human beings speaking to human beings across time and centuries. And so I think that's also how we saw criticism as a process of human beings speaking to humans and obviously teaching human beings speaking to humans in a continuity. It's not the only way to think of literature, but it was his profound conviction that that's what literature was about. And the virtue that accompanies that, and as I was thinking about my remarks today, I realized everything was coming down to maybe one virtue, the one that's been talked about all afternoon, generosity, or if you will, magnanimity, the most cheerful of virtues. So I'm gonna give you a sermonette, a cheerful sermonette on the most cheerful of virtues of magnanimity, the virtue that gives back, that passes on, that distributes, that makes the world wider and larger. Now, among the fundamental assumptions of the English literary tradition as a survey of British literature, is the following, that although much in the experience of literature will vary with individual response, there is such a thing as literary knowledge, and it can be the aim of a survey course to demonstrate what is knowable in literary study. As you can imagine, and probably remember in some many of your cases, his lectures were models of clarity and compression. He never spoke in an interesting sentence. He never rushed. He never ran over time. I listened to those lectures the first 6 weeks of the semester, tried to internalize all those qualities, and I didn't succeed, but I still remember his style. One graduate instructor during one of the years that Mike and I taught together pointed out that he taught like a science teacher. And you might know that Mike's first publication was actually in a science journal. It came out of the Abel Baker Charlie Project during the war. His first publication was in science. Nevertheless, of course, there was nothing cut and dried about his style. He had excellent taste, as you all know, in a stunning variety of aesthetic genres. And in his lectures, which always included a reading in that richly expressive baritone, texts would emerge as things of wit, beauty, clarity. I'm going to take you behind the scenes of that course just for a moment to talk about his relations with the staff. The staff of the course always included two or three grad students as well as one other instructor. The grad students taught many seminars and helped to grade the exams. So I'm going to tell you about grading day. On grading days, as Mike conducted them, we would begin in the morning in the faith of somehow grading every answer and every exam of some 90 notebooks by the end, or 90 blue books, by the end of a single day. So we'd start a half an hour to go over answers and raise oddball examples, and then we'd start grading, then lunch, then afternoon. On these occasions, by the way, you could get quite close to the famous Abrams energy, and I'll tell you what it looked like. He used to put the pipe in early in the morning, and that pipe would just steam all during the day, and he would work, right, until it was completed. It was neither the pace of the tortoise nor the hare, but a consistent, you know, mix of those two things, and it gave you confidence that, well, if he's going to get, he's definitely going to get through these 90 blue books today, so we are going to, somehow or other. And sure enough, by the day would end, with a grand listing of scores on the board converted into a letter grade. The reason that I think this experience lasts so much in my memory is that he interpolated the graduate students as professionals without making any fuss, without saying a word about it. What Wayne felt as a colleague of Mike's was a full, implicit acceptance of yourself as a competent professional, implicit, and it occurred, as I say, without condescension or show magnanimity towards colleagues. Now I'm going to fast forward to some years later. I cannot deny, or I can't avoid offering a very brief description of a course that he visited. It's going to recur to one of the themes this afternoon. It was I was teaching a course on irony and comedy in the 19th century, and I invited Mike to come and talk about Don Juan, one of his favorite works, and came into the class, and there were 14 young women and one young man in the class, and he could not get over it. And although I know he admired me for a number of things, he surely never admired me more than that day, because he seemed to think I was responsible for that. He said, "How do you manage that? That was just, how did you do that?" You know, and one of them was a ballerina afterwards. He, you know, it was a great day, but for him. But a very different visit was when he was 95. I asked him to come and lecture to his own course, the English literary tradition. It was chilly, typical English, Ithaca spring, and on the day I invited was the day that Keats's To Autumn was on the syllabus, the poem that Alice Fulton just read aloud to us. It was, we had to, he was 95, and so we had to drive up to the door of the building in the Ag Quad, and I certainly got a ticket. I mean, there's no way to park near the Ag Quad, as you know, without getting a ticket, but that's long gone. Mike was still hearty, but nevertheless, he was 95 years old. Those of you who have heard him read and discuss the last of Keats's great odes will be familiar with the gist of that lecture. He pointed out to the students, for example, that the poem is about death, or rather, about the acceptance of life as necessarily bounded by death. In that sense, the poem conceives of life as moving towards a telos, or a culmination, figured in the time of year when the fruits of the earth are ripening towards harvest. Mike also mentioned to the students that when Keats wrote the poem, he was 23 years and old and still healthy, but had reason to suspect that he would be short-lived like other members of his family. And in fact, a month later, Keats spat blood, wrote to a friend, "I must die." When the lecture was finished, the power of that occasion came from the weight of all that was unspoken. And I don't need to spell out to you what would have been unspoken that day, but to do so briefly, nevertheless, Abrams, full of fame and years, addressing students, themselves roughly Keats's age, from what must have seemed to them an immensely greater age, repeating and pondering with precision and tenderness the words of the young man whose career was about to be permanently shattered by disease. Abrams now living like Keats in the shadow and acceptance of death, but exemplifying the time figured in the poem. Auden remarked that poetry makes nothing happen, which may indeed be true, but that day I felt that Mike's visit suggested the immense power that poetry can have, or certainly an immense power that poetry can have. That poetry was not simply an inheritance from the dead, but a survival, as Auden also put it, in the mouths of the living, of students, of teachers, of readers. Mike loved to be with young people, as you all know, and I think that's one of the reasons, only one of the reasons, for the particular tenderness he had for Keats. Of course, who doesn't have a particular tenderness for Keats? He's the most lovable of figure probably in English literary history, but when I made a drawing of Mike and imagining him in the company of romantic poets, and I gave it to him for his 102nd birthday, the one thing I knew from the start was that Mike was going to have his arm around Keats like this. Keats was going to be beaming, and Mike was going to be grinning. Keats's grin, you know, that wide open, the ear-to-ear laugh of his. Keats's grin I had to imagine, but Mike's I didn't. I simply copied it. And now, as I think about Mike's deep chuckle, I'm going to back up to something else Mike used to say. He used to defend new editions in the Norton Anthology, particularly editions of women, by saying, it's all good. All about the end of the canon wars, if you put somebody in, you take somebody out, and so forth. And Mike would say, it's all good, it's all good. And Keats will still be good, no matter how many new authors there are. Everything is good. Life was not a zero-sum game to him. So when I think about Mike's deep chuckle now, I think of Dryden's famous sentence about the Canterbury Tales, here is God's plenty. For if for Keats, unheard tunes are sweeter. Heard tunes are sweet, but unheard tunes are sweeter. That's not true of laughter. Heard laughters are always the best, and it's our great good fortune that even though we won't hear Mike's laugh again, we have it in memory. That laugh, that smile, that seemed at times capable of taking in all the bounty of the earth. Thanks.
My name is Aishan Hutchinson, and this is the underrated Tennyson. Now sleeps the crimson petal. Now sleeps the crimson petal, now the white, nor waves the cypress in the palace walk, nor winks the goldfin in the porphyry font. The firefly wakened thou with me. Now droops the milk-white peacock like a ghost, and like a ghost she glimmers unto me. Now lies the earth all Donai to the stars, and all thy heart lies open unto me. Now slides the silent meter on, and leaves the shining furrow as thy thoughts in me. Now folds the lily all her sweetness up, and slips into the bosom of the lake. So fold thyself, my dearest doe, and slip into my bosom and be lost in me.
Beloved and distinguished M.H. Abrams is warmly known and remembered by all in this room as Mike. And we all gather today out of respect and gratitude for Mike and his life. Within the field of English literature, as an author, critic, professor, as the internationally respected general editor of the Norton Anthology from 1962 to 2006, as it was aforementioned, Mike's contribution is well beyond my understanding, well beyond my grasp. It is not possible for me, without a foundation of experience in Mike's area of expertise, to process the enormity of his distinguished reputation as the arbiter of the canon of English literature, founding general editor of the Norton Anthology, who served in that capacity for decades. Perhaps equally legendary was Mike's popularity as a mentor to students, many of whom became renowned contributors to their field because of his teaching, care, and guidance. My exposure to Mike was through his love and appreciation of Cornell athletics and his respect and admiration for our students who competed as true intercollegiate athletes. When I arrived at Cornell in the mid-70s as a young wrestling coach, I was unaware of Mike's academic accomplishments and his lofty standing in his field. I was also unaware of the significant contribution Mike made to the efforts of our armed services in World War II. To a young coach, he was simply the warm and highly respected professor who often attended football practice, traveled to football away games on the away team bus, and never, never, never missed a home football game. Over 65 years, Mike's attendance at home games at Schoolcraft was perfect. with the possible exception of maybe one or two games. But of those possible exceptions, no one can remember a single one. Not his daughters, not his family, no one in the athletics department. Mike also attended many lacrosse, hockey games, basketball games, wrestling matches, and heptagonal track competitions. He was, without question, universally regarded as the Big Red's number one fan. Perhaps the foundation of his interest in athletics developed at Harvard, where he competed for a place on the Crimson football, wrestling, and track teams. Mike explained that he was determined to take advantage of the physical nature of athletics opportunities available in college. Having devoted nearly all of his time and energy as a youth and through high school to academic pursuits, Mike explained that his wise and hardworking immigrant parents required full academic focus. While Mike's varsity experience at Harvard may have been brief, he certainly demonstrated a lifelong affinity and respect for collegiate athletes and followed Cornell teams religiously. I remember with fondness presenting Mike with a game ball commemorating the Big Red's 2010 NCAA run to the Sweet 16. The sheer delight emanating from his smile, especially expressive through his eyes, is etched in my memory. That smile, that moment in time, is how I will remember Mike. He was so proud of our basketball players and their historic accomplishment. We laughed at a comment from a Kentucky player interviewed by ESPN just prior to the game who warned, "This ain't no spelling bee." Mike was an inspiration to our student athletes and a particular source of pride for them. When such a distinguished member of the Cornell faculty demonstrated such interest and an authentic appreciation for Cornell athletes' commitment to both academic and athletic pursuits, it provided a considerable measure of credibility to an athlete's contribution to the campus community. Mike nurtured our student athletes in and out of the classroom like he treated all students under his care. Mike espoused that a challenging athletics experience contributes to education, helping to prepare a young adult to be more able to navigate the challenges that are inevitable in life. He expressed to me that much is learned in a competitive athletics arena that is not able to be learned in a classroom or a laboratory. Mike's impact on thousands of students, countless colleagues, friends, family members, Cornell University writ large, and Big Red athletics is immeasurable. Mike Abrams' memory will live on in all of us. And when you saw the reel of pictures earlier, there was a plaque that hangs in a conspicuous location in Bartels Hall with a bas-relief of Mike, and it outlines and delineates all that we have spoken about here this afternoon. Thank you so much for your kind attention. I love you, Mike.
I'm Joni Mikowski. I'm going to read a poem by Emily Dickinson. A bird came down the walk. He did not know I saw. He bit an angleworm in halves and ate the fellow raw. And then he drank a dew from a convenient grass and then hopped sidewise to the wall to let a beetle pass. He glanced with rapid eyes that hurried all abroad. They looked like frightened beads, I thought. He stirred his velvet head like one in danger, cautious. I offered him a crumb, and he unrolled his feathers and rowed him softer home than oars divide the ocean, too silver for a seam. or butterflies, off banks of noon leap, plashless as they swim.
Just add a footnote to Paul Sawyer's remarks earlier. He described the drawing he made of Mike surrounded by romantic luminaries with his arm around Keats and his attempt to capture Mike's laugh and Keats's smile. You saw that picture, that drawing, very briefly in the slide show earlier. But when we gathered to present this drawing to Mike, he looked at it and nodded sagely and said, "I must have just told a joke because I'm the only one laughing." So this was at age 102. Well, as we conclude this afternoon's proceedings, I want to thank Marianne Marsh, Sarah Rice, and the English Department staff, and Roger Gilbert, the chair of the English Department, for all the extra work they have done organizing this event at the busiest time of the year. And I want to invite you to visit the exhibition at the Johnson Museum that several of us have mentioned, works of art acquired by Cornell through the generosity of Mike and Ruth Abrams. And it's an exhibition that also includes materials of Mike from the Kroc Rare Book and Manuscript Collection. After the brief recording, which Mike reads a poem by our late beloved English Department colleague, A.R. Ammons, we invite you to a reception at Friends Hall overlooking Schulkopf Field, just up campus drive past the snazzy Gates Hall, the building with these glass shards on its facade. And you can look for the big red bear who is supposed to be out there pointing you in the right direction, though he or she will not speak. And finally, as you exit, we invite you to pick up the special keepsake that Julia mentioned, generously produced for us by W.W. Norton, Mike's longtime publishers. It's a small anthology edited by Roger Gilbert of passages of Mike's various writings from his earliest to the last. So please pick that up as you go out. Only one copy to a family, please. And now, Mansion by A.R. Ammons.
Mansion. So it came time for me to seed myself, and I chose the wind to be delivered to. The wind was glad and said it needed all the body it could get to show its motions with, and wanted to know willingly, as I hoped it would, if it could do something in return to show its gratitude. When the tree of my bones rises from the skin, I said, come and whirlwinding stroll my dust around the plain so I can see how the Acatillo does and how Sawararen is. And when you fall with evening, fall with me here where we can watch the closing up of day and think how morning breaks. Thanks for being such an attentive audience.